Hello and welcome to a new episode of the Open College podcast series. My name is Oksana and I'm going to be the host of this podcast. So with this episode, we're going to be talking to Femi Bankole. He's one of the founders of Black and Irish. And when speaking to Femi about Black and Irish, here's what he had to say.
Black and Irish was founded, probably like 6-7 months ago now. It feels like 10 years ago, I can assure you. But yeah, it was founded, the first week in June last year. And it was kind of initially was a platform that was aimed at bringing the conversation about race local and more specific to Ireland. I think at the start of the whole George Floyd case over the summer, a lot of the narrative that was being pushed around was around, hey, this is an American problem. You know, why are people out in the streets protesting an American problem? Why are people outraged by something that's America? And it kind of, you know, between myself, Bonnie and Leon, obviously it was Leon's initial idea, but we kind of came together as a group of three friends. And, you know, we've had experiences in terms of racial experiences in Ireland, growing up in Ireland. We all grew up in Ireland. And we hadn't necessarily even spoke to each other about the experiences. We hadn't spoken to anyone else about the experiences. But it was kind of like a silent thing that all Black people knew that they'd experienced. And we felt maybe that it was time to maybe push forward a platform or such an organization to kind of bring those stories and bring those experiences to the rest of the country. And then go from there. So that was kind of the inception of Black and Irish. That was the inception of the idea. And it's kind of just spun out of control into what it is today.
Yeah, no, it definitely has. Because I just seen recently that you guys have also started a podcast with RTE. And then you were also included. You're getting quite famous now, Femi. you're also in The Independent in their magazine. So I seen you that. Doing all that, so it's great.
To me, I'm just like, nothing has changed for me. I'm still the big EJ who just making things up as he goes. So for me, it's great, on the outside, but internally, it's just, you know, nothing much has changed. There's still a lot more work to do. And, you know, we especially with myself and the rest of the two lads, you know, we have our eyes fixed firmly on the prize, and that for us is making Ireland a more equal and inclusive place. And I personally feel we're still quite a long way away from that.
Yeah, it's quite evident though that you're quite successful at it. One of your quotes actually they got from another podcast that I was listening to that you were on, that you were saying you want to create a sustained spark but turn it into a flame. And I think you're actually like, you're getting there. Like it's like, you know, I was going to say worldwide, it's nationwide now, I suppose. Black and Irish is quite, you know, an Irish thing, obviously. So fair play to you guys. Like, that's,
thank you.
It's really cool. I really respect what you're doing. I wanted to also, I suppose, bring up the whole thing of like, how important is it for you guys, as founders, how important is it for you and for people to see what you're all about and what you're doing?
Yeah, it's massively important. But I suppose for us, it actually isn't about us. It isn't about, you know, myself, Bonnie, and Leon, or like Amanda, or the wider team. What we feel like is we're kind of like, you know, just enabling a conversation that's well long overdue to be had, and then further following on from the conversations. You know, it's not just about having the conversations. You know, what I always say is like, you know, something tangible has to come from this. Something, you know, what are the next steps? How do we then go about, you know, changing these experiences? How do we then go about making actual change? How do we then go about, you know, affecting real policies? You know, how do we go about bringing online discourse into the real world? And that's actually quite a very difficult thing to do. You know, when you talk about, you know, social media, when you talk about modern discourse, everything happens online usually. And when things happen online, you tend to, one, either get carried away, either you're stuck in an echo chamber, and it's very easy to be like, oh yeah, well, this thing is trending today, tomorrow's a new thing that's trending, and, you know, and so on and so on. And in that sense, nothing tangible ever gets done. Now, to flip that on its head and to actually like affect real change. So we're talking about making Ireland a more inclusive place for Black and mixed race people. Well, that needs to come from, you know, the top down and the bottom up. And what I'm talking about is maybe, you know, you start off in schools and the grassroots. You know, a common trend that we see from our page, from our stories, and from our own personal experiences, is that the bulk of our racial experiences, occur to us in our youth in primary, secondary school days, which are, you know, hugely developmental years for a kid. And, you know, those kind of experiences can have massive setbacks on, you know, people's emotional, mental development. So it's again, okay, grand. We've identified that problem and that trend through discourse. Now, how do you go about changing that? You know, are teachers being trained enough in terms of, you know, dealing with racial matters? Do we have a diverse enough teaching force to enable for that change to be sustained? Do we have, you know, the right materials and the right diverse materials in the curriculum to start to bulk and change that trend to start to, you know, make, you know, children of color feel more included, feel more adequately represented in the curriculum? So those are real things that you can actually do to affect, you know, the change and affect, you know, the experiences of, you know, young children, primary, secondary school. Now, how do you go about that? That requires lobbying the government. That requires maybe actually coming up with a new curriculum itself. That requires, you know, infiltrating, I'm saying that in inverted commas, infiltrating the teaching system and seeing, you know, why don't we have a more diverse teaching workforce? So, you know, we've only been around 6-7 months. So even me just saying those little things of one little section of the issues, you know, people of color face, you can see, you know, the amount of work that needs to be done. And you can see that, you know, it's great having a social media presence, but for real changes to be had, you know, that needs to be turned into something tangible to actually start to affect real long-term change. Do you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, no, definitely. And actually, as you were talking about school and how there isn't, like, the curriculum isn't very diverse and the teachers need further training and that kind of thing. Now, I'm not Black. I'm very, very milky, but I'm Russian. So I do kind of relate in a way when you're talking about that there isn't any, like, you don't see yourself in the things that are being taught.
Absolutely.
It's obviously not on the same level, but I do relate in a way to what you're just saying to me there.
When I talk about diversification of a curriculum, like, it's not just about, you know, making sure, like, you know, Black people are represented as such, but, like, you know, you can talk about even, like, just exposing kids to a variety of different cultures.
Exactly.
You know, if you want to teach people about, you know, like I said, Russian history. Russian has, like, a big, massive, colorful history. And even if you spend a week during the curriculum to teach children about different cultures, and that in its way already starts to trigger those kids to, you know, to kind of, like, expand their mindset and expand their point of view of the world to be like, you know, well, the world does not just revolve around me and my experiences, or revolve around, you know, what happens in Ireland or what's happening in Europe, and be like, you know, there's South American culture, there's African culture, there's Asian culture, and there's, like, you know, East Asian, West Asian, you know, there's so many things that you can open the eyes of your kids to. And, you know, rather than focusing on, you know, some subjects or some items that probably don't really have as much impact onto the development of a kid, you could flip the curriculum around to start to actually, you know, affect the active development and the broadening of a mindset of a child, you know?
Oh, yeah, no, definitely. And do you think it's just a case that people tend to be set in their ways? So I suppose with curriculum and even just how teachers are kind of, like, in Ireland, for example, to be a teacher, you have to have Irish. And if you come from a different country and you don't have Irish, well, you know, tough luck, you can't be a teacher, even though you could be the best teacher in the world. So what if you don't know Irish? So do you think there's just a sense of kind of being stuck in the past a bit?
No, absolutely. Absolutely. And when people talk about, you know, systematic racism or systematic discrimination, you know, you can argue that, you know, that sort of policy to state that, you know, you need to have Irish to become a teacher, regardless if you're teaching Irish or not, kind of illustrates that, because it means that, you know, people from other, you know, environments, cultures, countries can't access a job based off, a restriction that, if you want to become an Irish teacher, obviously you need to have Irish, but, or if you're going to be teaching, different bits of Irish, it makes sense. But for that to be, a policy that ostracizes a large majority, pretty much any foreign person from becoming a teacher, kind of points to, some sort of flaw in the system. And then to maybe just to answer your question in terms of, teachers being stuck in their ways. Yeah, absolutely. Like, especially, if you're talking about teaching, if you're talking about, the Department of Education, these are quite old and archaic structures in terms of how they operate. And they do absolutely tend to be stuck in their ways. Teachers have taught, the same curriculum for 10, 20, 30 years. It's very difficult for them to change. It's like, well, this is the way we've always done things. And, to bring about actual change in that sense, I personally feel has to come from the top, has to come from the government, has to come from the Department of Education. If the Department of Education were to make an active stance to really, really diversify the curriculum, the teachers in the schools would have no choice but to adopt that,
Oh, yeah, no, definitely. I suppose then when it comes to the Department of Education, and then in a kind of the Dáil, I suppose, there isn't really much representation when it comes to a diverse kind of amount of people there. So, like, I suppose my point is that if you're white and you grow up in a certain culture, it's not that you don't know anything else. It's just because that's kind of your world, it's your bubble. So if you don't have anybody else around you influencing your way of thought, so say, like, I don't know, me and you would be colleagues in the Dáil, we would talk about these things and maybe come to like an agreement on something and change things. But I suppose maybe the Dáil is quite whitewashed. There isn't much I don't think there's actually any representation in there, as far as I know.
What tends to then happen is that, oh, okay, well, if an environment is not representative of its population, what then tends to happen is that, let's say, as you said, the Dáil is, allegedly whitewashed. What that means is that, people are trying to, make policies or affect change based off their experience or their perceived perceived items that they feel like the public need. So if they're not being, if they don't have a diverse mind, if they're not interacting or, facing these issues that might affect minorities on a daily basis, nor do they have sight of those issues, then how can they affect policies or change to bring about a more inclusive, country, or a more inclusive curriculum or more inclusive policies? So it then goes back to the inherent bit to show that we actually need active representation in all these spaces to make sure that, the policies and the laws and everything else in between is actively representative and actively inclusive of the population.
Definitely, and I think that kind of goes out to media as well, sports, all these different areas that I suppose they kind of need to have more, like as you say, active representation in those areas. Like when you think about Irish media, I don't really know anybody who comes from much of a diverse background in Irish media. I know there's one girl in RTE, I think her name is Zainab Baladeel or something like that. She would be the only kind of girl that comes into my head as a TV RTE presenter who comes from a black background. Otherwise, I don't think I can think of anybody else.
And like, that kind of like tends to lead to like, people just not, consuming Irish media because, people feeling like, well, I'm not really represented in Irish media. So, oh, well, look, there's UK media and there's UK music and TV shows and TV, whatever, and they feel more represented there. And in that sense, I know quite a lot of creatives in different aspects, whether it's music, whether it's being an influencer, whatever the hell it is, who take the leap of being like, well, I'm going to leave Ireland because I don't see a space here for me. I don't see anyone, ahead of me, that I can aspire to. I don't see myself being able to break into the industry here. So I'm gonna move to another country like the UK or America, where I feel like we're more actively represented. So if again, there's two spaces to it. There's two prongs to it. It's like, one, if minorities are not being seeing themselves adequately represented in these spaces, such as media, whether it's TV, music. That automatically means that you have less minorities aspiring to be in those spaces because, you know, it's as you say, if I can't see it, I can't be it. And then secondly, you then have a second wave of it. If you do manage to get some minorities who get past that, who are still interested, who have the talent, who have the know-how, they don't see a space here for them in Ireland, and they start to leave the country. Now, saying that now, again, I'm not young anymore per se, but I do know that there is quite a lot of great Irish local talent who are regard, you know, disregarding these barriers as such, are still trying to make a space for themselves in Ireland, are still trying to, you know, break into the industry, or are still, you know, creating some, you know, some great media, some great music, TV shows, whatever the hell's going on. So it's not to paint everyone with the same brush, but just saying that we're putting ourselves at a disadvantage, especially in the media industry, by not making Ireland a more, you know, inclusive and accessible place for our talent, for people, minority groups.
Yeah, no, definitely. It's actually interesting that you say there about people our age, I suppose, that they don't really see anybody before us. But I do wonder, right, because you also mentioned the USA and the UK. Do you think, obviously, the US and the UK, they're quite ahead of us when it comes to being a more diverse culture? I would say how many decades? 30, 40, if not more. US, definitely a lot more. But in Ireland, like, immigration into Ireland has been, what, maybe in the last 20, 30 years that it has really kind of upped. So it will be people kind of my age and your age that will be kind of breaking the barriers and kind of doing these new things. Whereas before, our parents, who would have been the immigrants, because is it that you and I would be kind of considered first generation immigrant, isn't it? Because we're, yeah. So they would kind of arrived to Ireland and maybe they were a bit kind of, I don't know, maybe afraid or nervous or something, that they just kind of saw an opportunity. They came here for, you know, the better life, and they just wanted to make a good home for their family. Whereas you and I would be coming through, breaking the, how would you call it, the glass ceiling, maybe, or whatever you want to call it, and we would start seeing these opportunities and going out into them, to start, you know, for us to then be the people that the people before, after us, come up and see and say, yes, we can do this, and look at them, they did it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, no, absolutely, and that's, you know, really important in that sense to say that, you know, Ireland is still quite early on in its race journey, but that doesn't mean for us to be complacent either. You know, we're potentially still going down a path in which we're potentially, you know, we could make the same mistakes that the UK and US did, and you can see, you know, little rumblings of that, you know, based on, you know, just online discourse and like recent events. So we're at a quite a critical and crucial stage in Ireland in the next over the next 5, 10 years, in which we can, you know, become a far more inclusive country, put the systems in place to allow for more inclusivity across the entire country, across all spaces in the country. But, you know, the attitude and the zeal to do that has to be there. The opportunity has to be there. And, you know, we need to maybe seize upon that opportunity in the coming years to try and, you know, not make the same mistakes as other countries have on their racial journeys, and maybe learn from some of these other countries and maybe implement similar policies that we seem to have worked in these other countries. You know, for example, you know, like Ireland doesn't even have like hate crime legislation here. So it's like, you know, how do we expect there to be, you know, a more positive rapport between, you know, black people and law enforcement, is they feel like, you know, their issues and their worries and their you know, experiences based on race would not even be, you know, validated, or not validated, would not be, you know, understood by the police force. So it's like, well, listen, if I have a racial experience, there's no point in me even going to the Gardaí, because they're not going to deal with it, because we don't have any policies or laws in place in Ireland to combat that.
Then moving on to the US and what's going on over there. Obviously, it's Martin Luther King Day, on the 18th. And, you know, obviously he was a massive black rights activist. And then in comparison there, you have Trump at the moment, who is just, as people call him, the Cheeto or whatever it is in the White House at the moment. So obviously everything going on there, and then Biden coming in, he is just, like a bright light that people are trying to cling on to, who's going to be coming in on the 20th, do you think there'll be much of a change from, well, obviously there will be much of a change, but how much would you do you actually think Biden will be able to do with kind of moving society forward from what it is at the moment, from when he actually goes into his presidency?
Yeah, it's quite interesting, to be honest. You know, my own personal opinion is the American political system is one that has many, many, many flaws. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, it's always quite interesting. I always find it quite funny how people in Ireland, for example, would probably know a lot more about, you know, American politics than they would know about like our own politics locally.
I was betting to the elections. It was not even normal. I sat there, and when Biden got elected, I got really emotional. I was like, oh, this is great. We have it, like, because, you know what, to me, it was like this fight of good against evil. And to see the evil losing, I was so happy. I was like, we have a good person coming in. Because whether people like it or not, America is the biggest influence on society and the world at the moment. And to have someone that's actually a good, decent leader is massive.
Absolutely. And I think that was going to be my next point. I feel like, you know, I can understand why people, you know, are focused on, due to, you know, the influence America kind of has as a vast representation of society. Given the past 4 years, some change is absolutely needed. But I do want us to be very, you know, aware as well that, you know, for, I don't know what the split between the election was. I think it was like 55% or 60% to like 40%. Mm-hmm. But, you know, for all 60% who are, you know, liberal, who voted for, you know, Joe Biden and all that kind of crack, you know, there's also another 40% who are the total opposite. And we're in a society that I feel is probably more divisive than it's ever been. And what tends to happen and what I see is kind of on both sides, people just being ready to shut down and attack each other rather than, you know, maybe I think we all need to get to a stage now where we need to be able to, as much and as different other people's opinions are, and as much as we might not agree to it, we need to absolutely respect other people's opinions, other people's, you know, dispositions, other people's political opinions. And in that way, you know, we can actually start to, you know, find a way forward. As what I'm talking about here is, if you have like a staunch right wing person who you perceive to be racist and has and is like pro capitalist policies and pro, you know, I know, anti-liberal social policies, maybe, you know, engaging in conversation with those people is probably the best way forward. Because what I've got to realize over the past 6 months to a year is that, you know, on both sides of the table, you know, as a liberal, for example, you feel you're right. You feel that how can anyone else think other than this? And, you know, how is this unjust thing happening? But if you kind of like flip your thinking to put yourself in the shoe of the other person who's on, like, you know, the other side of the political spectrum, they're thinking the same thing. They're thinking, you know, what I'm doing is right. How can, you know, these liberals, for example, be thinking this alt way? Isn't it so obvious? So if we're in a society where everyone thinks what they're doing is right, and there isn't necessarily, you know, some sort of like ultimate moral compass as such, because at the end of the day, people are different. I think we need to get to a place now, rather than stoking that division, we need to get to a place where we can, you know, all exist in a way where we respect that people will have different opinions. And as long as those opinions and those, you know, political dispositions as such are not actively oppressing anyone, that's okay.
No, totally agree with you. I just think that would be quite a lot of barriers that would need to be broken down to actually get to a point, because people are we're human. Everybody's stuck in their ways. Some can be extremely stubborn. You believe what you believe. Actually, with America, what I find sometimes specifically now, look, I would openly say if I was in America, I'd probably be very much 100% Democratic. But I find that with the liberal side is you see interviews online with them and the questions that they're asked, and a lot of the stuff they don't really know the answers to, and especially young people, it just seems that they're Republican just because their family was that way, but they haven't really formed their opinion fully yet, or they've just grown up in this little small town somewhere in the Bible Belt, and it's just kind of how it is. That's kind of their bubble, that's their life, do you know? So to break down those kind of barriers for people to kind of...
Yeah, do you know what? My way of kind of looking at this, because you make a very interesting point, is that I think people are lazy in terms of their kind of political and personal beliefs. As in, you know, so for example, if I feel some way about something, or feel like this is wrong, or feel like I don't agree with this person's opinion, I actually personally like to like take my time and really, really think about it. Be like, okay, why do I feel that way? Am I just, you know, do I just have my back up because I hate being wrong? You know, what I always like to ask myself, like, you know, the three whys. So for example, you know, let's take something like, I know, controversial, which shouldn't be controversial, like gay marriage, right?
Okay.
And you know, for me, it's like, okay, a lot of people are against gay marriage, and a lot of people are for gay marriage, and I'm like, okay, how do I feel about this? And it's like, you know, I would know people who are gay, and I've interacted with them my entire life. Do I see an issue with them getting married? Like, no, why should there be an issue? You know, really, really understand your kind of grinding in your beliefs, rather than kind of like, you know, jumping onto what you feel like you should believe, jumping onto like, you know, your, you know, what's trending, or, you know, what's in your echo chamber. You know, like if you follow me on social media, I actually like tend to really refrain from posting about anything at all, you know, any sort of like, you know, political or societal discourse, because things happen so, so quickly that your opinions change, change all the time. And you kind of need to, you know, in a world where you need to, you know, be reactive, be on the point, be on the ball with your reactions and tweet in time and be on trend, maybe, and you know, that actually sets some sort of a, you know, dangerous rhetoric in the sense that, like, you know, give yourselves a minute to formulate your opinions. Give yourselves a minute to say, you know, before you send that tweet, before you, you know, before you engage in a back and forth with someone, you know, do your research. Why do I feel that way? Listen. What I started doing very, very recently is that when I have an opinion of something, right, rather than, you know, watching videos and doing research of people that have the same opinion as me, I watch videos or do research on people who have the opposing opinion as me. And what that either does is it makes me even stronger in my opinion as to why I'm against this. Or it makes me think, okay, maybe I'm against this for the wrong reason. Do you know what I mean? You know, being in an echo chamber where everyone feels the exact same way as you. And that way you're not really challenging your opinions. You're not actually really fully formulating your own opinions. You think you are. We're being kidded into thinking we formulate our own opinions. We're being kidded into thinking we are, you know, thinking for ourselves. And, you know, we are like, you know, for example, right, as controversially as it might sound, you know, I would say myself, I'm like center left, you know, liberal. Okay.
Yeah.
But when I go in and do some research and look at economical policies and social policies, I'm like, oh, wait, I actually agree personally with a lot of things that happens on the right side. On like, you know, on the right economical side or the right social side. So that doesn't necessarily mean that, you know, every time I hear someone right wing, whatever, talking about something, it's like, well, I have to disagree with that because I'm left wing. We have to take each situation as it is and critically think about it and critically, you know, kind of formulate, you know, our own thoughts on it, rather than, you know, maybe focusing on, or sorry, taking on what the status quo is or what's expected of me because of my own, you know, perceived beliefs.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I think in Ireland we're kind of lucky in that kind of sense that we can be a floating voter, as they say as well. I feel like in America it's not really, well, from what I see anyway, I mean, I don't live there, but from what I see, it's like you're either one or the other and that's it. There isn't much of a change. Whereas here, like you said, you can do your research if you're smart enough to go off and do your research and make a decision. You don't have to be one or the other. You can move around, do you know?
Yeah, and I think in Ireland, you know, we're in a generation, you know, who prior to this would have been accused of not maybe being politically tuned in. But I'd say, the younger generation right now is probably more politically tuned in and more tuned into social issues than ever, which is a great thing, but also maybe a slightly dangerous thing in terms of, people not actively challenging their own ways of thinking. And if challenging your way of thinking doesn't necessarily mean, trying to, think on the opposite sides or whatever. It's just for me putting yourselves in someone else's shoes for just a minute to either really, really, confirm how you feel or maybe bring yourself into, a different point of view.
Yeah, well, no, I agree with you definitely. You have to. Otherwise, you're just kind of narrow-minded, aren't you, to be stuck in your own kind of way? I suppose
Absolutely.
kind of moving as well away from all the political talk. Have you
Yeah.
experienced, well, I suppose it would be kind of political, but my next question, I suppose, is have you experienced racism yourself or
Yeah,
any
of
kind of
course.
discrimination?
Yeah, of course. I've experienced a lot of discrimination growing up. It's actually funny. During the whole summer and everything like that. That's like I never stopped to think about the racial experiences that I've had. I'm quite, my personality is I'm quite like a positive, happy person, forward kind of a person, and I don't deal with my emotions, basically, being honest about it. And I never kind of, I'd have different experiences, and I never kind of like stopped and take note. I just brushed them off, like, ah, yeah, it's grand, and just move on to the next thing. And it wasn't until like the summer, when I was doing like different like Insta lives and like chatting, and I even like chatting to my sister, and she'd be like telling me all these different things that like happened growing up, and I'm like, oh my God, yeah, man, I totally forgot about that. Oh my God, I didn't even see that in that way. And it's kind of like, in the moment when things are happening to you, you don't necessarily see them as like, overt or covert racism. And it's not until you kind of like think back at them, think back to those moments, you're like, oh crap, these different things happened to me, these different things have kind of like shaped the kind of person I am today. These different things have had these different emotional, effects on me. And that's when you really kind of like, start to think about like the different racial experiences that you had. I even had like a racial experience, as recent as like, I think it was like just before lockdown, like in like January, February last year. And I think I was on a night out with two of my white mates, just on Dawson Street, in town, and we're all like, I don't know, like very, very drunk, whatever. We're trying to get into an establishment on Dawson Street, and like the bouncer wasn't having any of it. He was just like, "You aren't going in," which is fine. We were just like, obviously like trying to like chance our arms, and then like this guy walks by us, and he's like, "Yeah, black to the back of the line." I was like, "Oh my God!" So obviously, I remember like my two white mates were, very, very incensed at the situation, and we're trying to like, fight the guy or whatever, and I, calmed the situation down, and I the bouncer who was there actually saw what happened, and he was like, oh my God, I'm so sorry that happened to you, and he let us in. But what I'm actually trying to take out of that situation is that did not register to me as a racial event. I did not remember that. I did not even remember that the next day. And it wasn't until I was on a Insta live about 6 or 7 months afterwards. And I was chatting about like my racial experiences, and someone's asking, have you had like any recent racial experiences? I was like, oh no, I haven't really had anything happen to me or whatever. Like, And my mate was messaging me, be like, Femi, I was there like 3 months ago when this happened to you. And I was like, oh my God. So like, what happens to me is I have all these different experiences, and I just totally like internalize them. I don't deal with them. I don't, I don't confront them in a way. And it's something that I'm, actively trying to work on, at this time. I'm laughing now, but it is, quite sad in the way that I've maybe kind of become desensitized to some of these experiences that I have, that I don't even see them as a big deal, and hence it doesn't register with me, nor do I like, remember them,
Oh no, I talk like I know I kind of relate, but now maybe it's the same for you. But for me, now obviously I don't know if you were born here or you moved here when you were quite young. For me, I moved here quite young, and when I moved here quite young, I made the like I remember this, and as an adult, I would talk about it openly. But as a kid, I'd be like, no, you don't need to know my business. But as a kid, I was really, really like put so much effort into not hiding that I'm Russian. but not acting that I'm Russian. I really wanted to fit in and be so Irish. So do you think it was a case maybe that you kind of omit these experiences in your mind because maybe from a young age, you also kind of wanted to fit in more into the way society is, and do you know that these bad experiences, you're like, no, we just won't think about that, like.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And whether I want to admit it to myself or not, you know, what every teenager wants and every young person wants is not to be different. It's to be like part of the status quo, if that kind of makes sense. You know, like you don't want to stand out. You don't want to be bullied for anything. You don't want anything to necessarily like stand out about you, which is stupid and funny when you think back about it, because, you know, being an adult, all you want to do.
Exactly. You want to be the different person. Yeah.
But yeah, when you think about that, so yeah, absolutely. You know, I definitely try to, you know, not necessarily hide my blackness, but, you know, I'd say I was definitely ashamed of my culture in my youth. I was ashamed of who I am. And it wasn't until, and, you know, I would say part of that was because, you know, society made me feel that way. You know, it wasn't fashionable or flashy to be black. You know, I had a big wide nose and really short hair and dark skin and big lips, you know, all things that I used to be made fun of when I was a kid, you know, all things I'm very proud of now, like in my adult age. But it just means that, like, you know, in these key developmental years, you know, between like 12 and 21, I'm spending all this extra effort hating myself, trying to change myself to fit into the status quo. Whereas, you know, now in my older age, I'm just unapologetically black. I'm unapologetically Femi. That's me. This is who I am. This is how I feel about things. This is how I feel comfortable in my own skin. And I will debate anyone to the ends of the earth who tries to tell me otherwise, you know.
But that's what you have to be, because if we were all the same, it would be such a boring life. Like, everything would just be like, you know, gray. It would just be boring. Everybody has to be different and be themselves, and just that's it. Yeah. You know, like you said, unapologetically Femi.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, as bad as it may sound, like, I'm sick of having my race define me. I am far more than the color of my skin. The color of skin does not define who I am, does not define how I act, does not define. I am just myself, a human being that who's been shaped by his own life experiences. And I'm just, you know, just trying to get along in life and in the world, as we all are, you know. Life is difficult, as we all say. And, you know, the less things that each person has to worry about, you know, the better quality of life you can tend to have, like, you know.
Yeah, like you say all this and every single bone in my body is like, oh my God, a person relates to how I lived. It's crazy. Because everything you say there about, like, you're unapologetically you and all these kind of things, I felt the exact same way just as I started to get older. Because I always felt, and it's only until like recently that I kind of started to get more mature, because, you know, being 30, it's only getting there for me. But I found that I was always stuck in this like cultural limbo. Like, I'm on this fence. Like, I'm not Russian, I'm not Irish. When I go to Russia, I don't really fit in anymore because I've been shaped, like, Russian parents raised me, but Ireland shaped me. So I feel really like I go over there, people look at you as if like you're not from here, even though, you know, my name's Russian, everything, I speak Russian fluently, you wouldn't be able to tell. And then here it's like, well, you're not actually really Irish, even though you sound Irish. I did everything here. I grew up here. I feel very Irish. I feel more Irish than I am Russian, to be honest. And it's just,
you know what's funny about that, right? Because, you know, I get it from like both sides personally. It's like, oh, well, you're not black enough, this or that, or I've not immersed myself into my African culture, or I'm not Irish enough, or I've over immersed myself into Irish culture. And personally for myself, I just see myself as a you know, quasi Irish Nigerian person. I've taken the best of both cultures and I've mixed it all together, and that's maybe the kind of person I am. I'm absolutely proud to be Nigerian, proud to be Yoruba, proud of my culture, proud of my upbringing. Love every aspect of me that's, you know, that's Yoruba, which is where I'm from, which is, like, you know, the tribe I'm from in Nigeria. But I also love every part of me that's Irish. So, you know, even when, you know, people are trying to be like, you know, oh, being Irish is this, being Irish is that, I'm like, hey, you can't say that. That's me you're talking about. Or if people are trying to, again, do the same to, you know, being a Nigerian Yoruba, I'm like, no. So it's kind of like a nice fusion of both cultures. And I think that's quite unique. And that kind of, you know, I kind of came to that place a few years back. And I'm just like, Do you know what? I'm not gonna try and pander to either culture. I'm just gonna be, as I say, a product of my environment and be happy in taking the best parts of both cultures and develop as the kind of person that I see myself of wanting to be. I'm not gonna, kind of push myself to fall into any societal construct of how a black or a Nigerian Yoruba person is supposed to act, or how a black Irish person is supposed to act. I'm just gonna act how I feel I want to act, what suits my personality, what suits my way of being, and what makes me happy. Because at the end of the day, life's too short to be pandering to what makes the masses happy, or to see yourself in what box society feels like you need to tick to be,
Exactly.
accepted,
No, definitely. Like, as long as you're a good person, sure, what nothing else matters,
So I
in my
don't know if
opinion,
I'm a good
anyway.
person now, anyways, but that's another debate.
Ah, stop. You're a good person. That's it. Oh God, it's actually funny that you mentioned the whole thing of like, your blackness doesn't define you and all this kind of thing. I found I had this conversation with my partner as well, where we're planning a wedding, and we first started talking about like how I should incorporate all these Russian things into the wedding, and I was like, hang on, like me being Russian is not just who I am, like it doesn't define me. So I just kind of thought that was an interesting tidbit that I was like, I fully relate to that as well. Like it's my life. Like
And
all the time.
this isn't like a dig off, let's say, like a black person who's black and Irish and who really just wants to embrace and engulf themselves only in their Nigerian culture. That's totally fine. Or if
Oh
you're a
yeah.
black and Irish person who just fully wants to immerse yourself in Irish culture, that's also totally fine. Like, each to
Yeah.
your own. I'm kind of
That's it.
like sick of people trying to, because let's say like you're a black and Irish person and you really just fully immerse into Irish culture and you kind of like, turn your nose up at, black people who fully immerse themselves into Nigerian culture or vice versa. Like, it doesn't matter at the end of the day. I think people need to stop trying to put everyone else into some sort of box. And if someone does not fit into the same box that you kind of you put yourself in, then there's something wrong with them, or you turn your nose up at those people. Like, life's too short for that, in my opinion.
No, definitely. Just embrace everybody and live and let live is what I say as well.
That's it.
Yeah, no, definitely. Okay, I'm gonna have to wrap this up, I suppose, Femi. I'm gonna have to leave you go. I've kept you here long enough. I think it's nearly an hour now. So thank you so
Fine.
much for coming on and having a chat with me.
No, thanks for having me on. I totally enjoyed it. I feel like I've poured out all my emotions online.
And that was Femi Bancole on Black and Irish. I hope you enjoyed this topic as much as I did. If you want to listen to more of any of our episodes, you can find us by searching the Open College podcast series on any of the usual podcast platforms that you listen to. Thanks again for listening.